Today, we are looking at John chapter 20. And the reading is this. Jesus has been crucified by this stage in John's gospel. And on the third day, he's been raised from the dead. And this reading, from verse 19, he appears to the disciples for the first time, and he shows them his scars. So let's read together. John chapter 20, beginning on verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where his nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was there. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my side. Reach out your hand and put it into, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." I wonder, do you have a physical scar? When I was younger, growing up, my best friend lived about a 10-minute walk from our house, and we'd always go around to each other's house to play. And his father was, at the time, perhaps the West's leading academic on the Japanese banking system. So they had a whole room in their house that they called the Japanese room. And we were told quite clearly that we were allowed to play anywhere in the house apart from in the Japanese room. Now, of course, if you tell two young boys you cannot play in that room, what's the one room that we wanted to play in? The Japanese room. So this one time we sneaked in, and it was indeed like an Aladdin's cave. There were Japanese artifacts. There was an entire wall full of amazing books on Japan. And we found this one book that we particularly liked. It was a translation of an ancient Japanese book called The Book of Five Rings by Miyamoto Musashi, the greatest samurai swordsman that had ever lived. He was undefeated, and in this book, he explains, and it was illustrated, all his strategies for swordsmanship. Wow. I was transfixed. I wanted to be Miyamoto Musashi. The next time we crept in, we got the book down again, we read it, and then we took hold of the wooden swords that were in the room, the bokken, and we started to fight with each other. It was such fun. The next time we sneaked into the room, it's funny how things escalate, right? The next time we sneaked into the room, we got the book by Miyamoto Musashi. We looked at it, and then together, almost simultaneously, without saying a word, our eyes were somehow attracted to the ultimate objects in the room. The real samurai swords. Oh yeah. So we climbed up and we brought them down. Then we unsheathed them. I no longer wanted to be Miyamoto Musashi. No. I was Miyamoto Musashi. Now, if you're a parent at this stage, you're probably going to come out in a cold sweat, because we did something that is definitely not advisable. We started to sword fight with the samurai swords. I was transported back to feudal Japan. I was the greatest swordsman who had ever lived. And I thought as we were fighting, I needed to end with a flourish that was befitting for such a swordsman. So I jumped into the air and I decided I would land in my best samurai swordsman stance. I had no clue what a samurai swordsman stance was, so I did the only thing I had seen on television. I landed like this. But the problem was, my friend was so shocked by me leaping in the air, he instinctively put out his sword. And stabbed me in the chest. I still have the scar today. Now, your story might not sound as dramatic as that one. But here's the thing. It's impossible to go throughout life without getting scars. Maybe your scar's a physical one. But perhaps yours is an emotional scar that you carry. Or a relational scar from a relationship. Or maybe even a spiritual scar. And we tend to be afraid or even ashamed of our scars. But Jesus is different. After the cross, when Jesus is resurrected, he could have chosen any type of resurrection body that he wanted. I know I would have seriously been tempted to go for an upgrade. And his resurrection body is amazing. He can appear into that room with the disciples even when the door is locked. It's special. And yet, he chose to keep the scars. Now you might say, well, wasn't that just then so he could show it to the disciples? Surely not now that he's ascended into heaven. No. We're told in Revelation chapter 5, John's vision gives us a picture of the throne room of God, and there the Lamb of God, which is a title for Jesus, is seated on the throne. And it says, looking like one who was slain. The resurrected Jesus still bears the scars of the cross. Why? Well, there are three things that we associate and that we associate negatively with scars, which Jesus views completely differently and which will transform not only our attitude to scars, but also help us to understand the significance of his scars and why his scars can completely transform your life and mine. So, firstly, we associate scars with being ugly. You know, in our image-obsessed culture, being seen as ugly is generally thought of as being one of the worst possible things that could happen to us. We're afraid of being ugly in case we won't be accepted or we'll be unloved. I was shocked to read that last year, the U.S. spent more than $13 billion on cosmetic procedures. That's more than the annual economic output of any of the poorest 65 nations in the world. And do you know what the fastest growing cosmetic procedure is? Buttock implants. I can't believe it. Buttock implants. And these things are not cheap. I mean, talk about sitting on your assets. I don't know why they don't just eat nasi lemak. It does the same thing. It's far more enjoyable and a lot less expensive. I also read that if you look at all the photos posted on Instagram, one third of them are selfies. It seems in our culture, we're desperate to project an image of ourselves that we hope will be approved of, that we hope will quite literally be liked. When I read that stat, I went to my own Instagram feed to check, and I was shocked with what I found. There were photos of me, me, me. And then it got to the point when we moved to Malaysia, and it went, me, food, food, food. I've clearly swapped one obsession with another. But here's the thing. I'm not saying that it's wrong to take care over our appearance. No. I'm not saying that it's wrong to have a cosmetic procedure. I'm not even saying that it's wrong to post selfies. But until we have a correct understanding of beauty, it will remain forever an ideal that no matter how hard we stretch to reach it, it will remain elusive and leave us feeling ugly. In Mark chapter 7, Jesus said, it's not what's outside the body that then comes in and makes us unclean, but it's what comes from the inside. In the Old Testament, the people chose Saul as their king because of his appearance. He was tall. Still today in the West, over 90% of CEOs are more than 6 feet tall. But God chose David, saying that man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. You see, this is the truth of the matter. Sin is ugliness, and holiness is true beauty. It is sin that makes a person ugly, and it is holiness that makes us beautiful. And let that truth liberate and inspire us. Because Jesus was not afraid to embrace ugliness. He took the ugliness of our sin upon himself on the cross. And an exchange took place on the cross. Our sin was placed, our ugliness was placed upon him. And in exchange, we receive his righteousness. Redemption makes you and me beautiful. Jesus redefines beauty. The prophet Isaiah, centuries before, prophesied of Jesus that there would be nothing special in his appearance that we should desire him, but his holiness is so attractive. In Proverbs 31, where it's speaking of the wife of noble character, not of noble appearance, but of noble character, it says this, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. She is worth far more than rubies. It is the redeemed man or woman who on the inside reflects the beauty of Christ. Jesus makes us holy. We can't earn it. It is quite literally a free gift of righteousness that comes simply by faith. So today, let the scars of Jesus make you beautiful, holy. Secondly, we tend to associate scars with being broken. And we don't want to be broken because being broken is painful and it's sort of a sign of fragility. Nobody wants to be thought of, I suppose, like one of those parcels with the words fragile, handle with care, written on them. But we all break at times. Maybe you felt broken in the past, or maybe right now in your life, you feel broken physically. Maybe you're worn out, or emotionally, you're just wobbling. Or relationally, you feel like you're in a broken relationship right now. Or maybe spiritually, you're feeling burnt out. Or perhaps you sense God is calling you to something and it just feels too costly. What if I get hurt? Maybe it's where he's placed you, or you're in a costly relationship, or you've been given a task to do, or maybe work is so tough, you're just afraid of being broken. But Jesus was not afraid to be broken. And in being broken, he makes us whole. And we can't fix ourselves. I suffer from something called keloid scarring. Apparently, it's really quite a rare condition in Caucasians. Auntie Chichao, who used to be a nurse, told me it's far more common in Asia. She thinks it's my inner Asian coming out in me. But keloid scarring is where, let's say you get cut, your body produces scar tissue to heal, but then it keeps on producing too much scar tissue. The body, as it were, overheals itself. Maybe you are, as it were, overcompensating in an area of your life where you've been scarred. You don't want to be hurt again, so you overprotect or you overheal. But as it says in Isaiah chapter 53, it is by Jesus' wounds that we are healed. Jesus redefines healing. He makes us whole. In the New Testament, which was written in Koine Greek, the word for whole and the word for save, it's the same word. He makes us whole. And forgiveness leads to wholeness. That's why in our reading in verse 23, it says, if you forgive anyone their sins, they are forgiven because of the cross. Just let, once again, I know it's simple, but let the power of that truth sink deep into your very being right now. Whatever you have said or thought or done in the past, whatever you think or say or do today, and whatever you think or say or do tomorrow that is wrong, you are already forgiven. This is not cheap grace. It costs Christ everything. But we are forgiven. And because of Jesus' scars, you can know the freedom and the wholeness of forgiving anyone who has scarred you. Nothing, no one, no relationship is beyond redemption. As it says in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. That is not obligation or duty. That is freedom. So let the scars of Jesus today set you free and make you whole. Complete healing is yours. I often think that this notion of Jesus making us whole, it's a bit like the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is both now, it's broken in with the coming of Christ, but it's also not yet. His kingdom is advancing, but it's not here in its fullness until Christ returns at the end of time. It's a bit like that with our wholeness. We are not yet fully, completely whole, and we won't be until Christ comes again. But the wholeness that comes through what he's done and knowing Jesus has already broken into this world and can break into your life today if you don't know him. And my suspicion is this, that you and I, we are already more whole. We are already more healed than we realize. We just need to have the eyes of faith to walk out in that healing, in that wholeness. Let the scars of Jesus make you whole. Then the third thing that we tend to associate with scars is we associate scars with being weak. You know, scars in a way can be a sign of failure. My scar right here in my chest, it's a sign of failure in a sword fight. I failed to be as good as Miyamoto Musashi. And we tend to hide our scars because we think we'll impress people with our strengths. But actually, we connect with other people through our vulnerabilities. And Jesus was not afraid to appear to fail. You know, the cross appeared to be a very public failure for Jesus. Those who were crucifying him taunted him, saying, "Look, he claims to be able to save others, but he can't save himself." But Jesus, in our reading in John 20, he seems very keen to show his scars to the disciples. Why? Because they're not actually scars of failure. They're scars of victory. The resurrection was not the reversal of a defeat, but rather a manifestation of a victory. Jesus' scars are proof of what he's done for you and for me. They are victory. And Jesus' scars, let's not forget, they were so severe that he died because of them. But death could not hold him. That which brought him death brings you and me life. And often Jesus takes the scars in our own lives and through them brings life to us and to others. You know, I know drug rehab centers that are run by ex-addicts who came to Christ. I know of prison ministry happening all around the world, being run by ex-convicts who came to Christ. I know of shelters for vulnerable women being run by women who themselves have a history of abuse in their lives, but who came to Christ. Jesus converts our scars from a sign of weakness to a sign of redemption, from a sign of death into a sign of life. And all of it is possible only because of his scars and what they've achieved for us. And what was the disciples' spontaneous reaction when they saw the scars of Jesus in John chapter 20? It was joy. Verse 20 says this, "After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed." In Hebrews chapter 12, it says of Jesus, that for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Being crucified is not in itself an enjoyable experience, but it was for the joy set before him, the joy that he would have by seeing the joy that his cross would bring us, that that verse is referring to. His scars bring us joy. And Jesus shows us his scars, and he says, I'm alive. These scars no longer bind me, and through them I have brought you freedom. So rejoice. Let the scars of Jesus bring you wholeness, healing. Let them bring you beauty, holiness. And let them bring you joy, happiness. There was a young man called Scott. He was not a Christian, but he came to church because he was desperate. 4 years previously, he had been knocked off his scooter, off his moped, and had a very bad accident. He'd broken his shoulder blades that had misaligned and damaged a lot of the muscle and tissue around his spine. He had difficulty walking and was in pain every day for 4 years. But he came to church, and in the service, a word of knowledge was given from the front that there was somebody who'd had a motorbike accident, damaged their back, and that the Lord wanted to heal them. So he responded, he was prayed for, and immediately the pain went. And he was so surprised because it got to a stage where he was booked in very soon to have back surgery. But when he was prayed for, the pain went. So he went to the doctors to have it checked out. And this is what he then wrote to us, saying, thanks so much for all the help, the prayer and support you guys gave me. It has enabled me to walk. I'm happy to say my back is still feeling great and not causing me any pain at all. As I said, I was due for an operation on Thursday. So as scheduled, I went in and explained to the surgeon exactly what happened. He x-rayed my back, and the x-ray showed my shoulder blades were perfectly in line with each other, and there looked to be absolutely nothing wrong with any of the muscles down my spine. The doctor was speechless, and he said that there is no way that that could be physically possible without surgery. So I am overjoyed, for Jesus is beyond my wildest dreams. Never in 4 years have I experienced anything like this. I'm still breathless at it now. You know, 700 years before Jesus was even born, the prophet Isaiah in chapter 53 prophesied these words about Jesus. And really, it sums up everything I've been saying today. This is Isaiah 53 from verse 2. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Amen. Would you like to stand, please?